patient or something, but even knowing how a patient flows through a hospital, or what the difference between a clinic visit and an inpatient visit is, or, you know, the differences in the technology between the two, or the roles of a nurse versus a physician versus an MA versus an LVN, all these terms and things, that knowledge is small, and so I kind of try and help translate that, so we build technology that's user-centered and user-centric and that kind of stuff. So I have a fun job. We get to play with a lot of stuff. I work with really smart techie people that get all the latest and greatest things. We meet with startups regularly and coach startups. We talk to them, assess their technology on a weekly basis. We go through about 10 or 12 technologies a week, new emerging technologies coming from all over the world. And then we pick those to test out. And then on the kind of the structure side of things, we're actually building a new model of innovation for Kaiser Permanente to kind of lead our company into the future. We've been a leader in an integrated system, and now we're trying to figure out how do we redefine ourselves and continue to be out front. So it's kind of a fun position to be in, and an interesting thing. So I'm going to talk to you today about kind of where we see some technology going in the future, kind of the role of nurses, because sometimes people are like, well, nurses just sit there and they do what the doctor says. We actually have a license ourselves. We can practice independently. Yes, sometimes we follow doctor's orders, but most of the time we're working on our own practice, our own license, and we spend the most time with the patient, so we know a lot, and we take in a lot of data, and we translate that to family members, to other care team members, all kinds of stuff. So I'll kind of talk about where that role might fit in the future. And then lots of time for questions. I have a couple videos, two quick short ones, about how we imagine the future, and we'll kind of go from there, and then lots of questions, and then Faye will talk about 2025 as well. So just to give you some context, I know Dr. Chow talked to you guys recently, and he's awesome, and he used to work with me too, so it's all kind of coming together. Dr. Chow's awesome. But you know this picture, and it's been around for a while. You know, it's increasing demand because we have more insured. We have increasing cost. Healthcare is just expensive. You can look at Martin Shkreli and see that you can jack up the price of a drug for 7,000 or 700 times its cost, and really no one can do anything about it. So we have increasing costs. Outcomes in the U.S. are actually below 24 other countries in the world, which is pretty sad because we spend a crap load of money on it and we don't get the same outcomes as other countries. And then the reimbursement model is shifting, right? So it used to be volume. How many patients did you see? How many surgeries did you see? How many medications did you prescribe? How many things did you do? And it's shifting to value, which is how many things did you do that mattered? So if you did a surgery, did the outcome improve? If you did the surgery, did you not infect them so they had to stay longer in the hospital? In the past, if you did a surgery and the patient got infected and they had to stay 4 more days, you could bill the insurance company for those 4 days. Now, with the changing Affordable Care Act, if the hospital's responsible for causing an infection during a surgery or procedure or whatever, that hospital eats the cost of the extended care time. So that's a shift that didn't used to be there. So it's taking the burden off the patient to pay for the mistakes, putting it back in the system. And not all systems are set up to do that. You know, Kaiser's interesting because it's integrated, and so we partner with the physicians and the hospitals and the health plan. It's all one system, so we all connect the dots. But in other systems, the insurance company is completely separate from the physician group, which is completely separate from the hospital, and now they're all trying to negotiate with each other on what's going to happen. So there's a lot of there's a lot more process there, and they're all trying to shift to combine resources and make these accountable care organizations and things. But it's very different how the reimbursement is happening. And then the Center for Medicare and Services, which really sets the bar for reimbursement, is lowering what they pay for things. So money is becoming tighter, resources are becoming tighter, and they have to do more with it. They have to perform better with less, and so people are trying to figure out how to do that. And then you have the workers, which are shifting as well. So we have to just rethink things. So just to give you a picture, I actually stole this from Dr. Chow. The old approach was episodic visits, clinician-centric. You came to the care system controlled everything you did. There was no transparency in your data. You didn't know what the doctor wrote about you. You didn't know what anything cost. Everything was controlled by the system. And that's been completely flipped to transparency and consumer-led. So now there's things called open notes where you can read exactly what the physician writes about you and carry your medical record with you on a drive or on your computer and take it wherever you want to go. It becomes portable. It's a continuous relationship. It's about care management over time rather than I see you, I give you a pill, and don't come back, right? So it's just a shift in how things are happening, and it's different because the healthcare systems now are set up in this 21st century industrial model where they were set up to do a lot of volume, and they're trying to shift to be value. And so that's why there's so much change in technology and opportunity in healthcare is because these companies don't know what to do. And there's these people that have all these great ideas, and you can see the consumer boom with Amazon and all these consumer experiences that are one-click, you know, expectations. They're trying to introduce that into the healthcare system. So there's a really great opportunity there to connect the dots. There's a lot of talk about physicians, and we need physicians, and we need nurses, and we need all the roles that are happening. But what tends to happen is, especially because I meet with a lot of startups, is that everyone tries to solve for the physician. And that's great. They have a lot of stuff they need to solve for. But there's also the biggest employee pool within healthcare is nurses. There's, I think, 6 million nurses in the country. In Kaiser, just to give you some perspective, there's about 18,000 physicians that work in all of Kaiser, in all of our 7 regions, 36 hospitals, cover 10 million patients, right? There's 50,000 nurses. So we're 3 times as big of a workforce, and we touch the patients for 99% longer. So a physician visits 15 minutes, a nursing visit is 24/7. So it's just a different thing to think about, and nurses are really there to assess patients, keep them safe, give them medications, make sure they connect the dots, and they actually coordinate care between all of the pieces. They're kind of this central integral piece of connecting the physician's diagnosis and treatment plans to the family's wishes and needs, to the patient, to the community, to the care outside of the walls of the healthcare system. So all of those things together, nurses fit there. We are really good at triaging lots of information. Because you can imagine an intensive care unit, you sit there with tons of monitors, tons of electronic medical record data flowing. We have to translate that into actionable things on a consistent basis. So then you think about moving things outside of the hospital to the home. And we're talking about wearables and all this data that's going to flow. And we're going to know everything that you do, your heartbeat every second, 10,000 blood pressures a day, how much you run, how much you eat, you know, how close you are to getting diabetes, all that kind of stuff. And then you're like, well, who's going to look at all that? And we need machines to do some of it and help triage it. But nurses are really good at doing that now. They do it because they read through these medical records every single day and they triage this information. They pick out risk scores and they assign risk scores and they're able to assess patients and the needs and things. So nurses are really positioned well to take in a lot of data, triage it, and be able to kind of move the care to where it needs to happen, both with the patient and to the other care team members. And then you also see and hear both a nursing shortage, but also a physician shortage. And now that we have 60 million or however many more insured we have in the country, we don't have enough care providers to do that, to provide primary care. Like you get a sore throat and go into the doctor, like we don't have enough people to do that for everyone in the U.S. So we have to think differently about licensing, right? So physicians can diagnose and treat, but so can advanced practice nurse practitioners. And so we need to think about where the licensing is and what roles and who does what in the system so we can actually be more efficient with the care. And I'll talk about a couple models that show that top of license or whatever. So just to give you, so 2025, what's going to happen? There, we could be up to 100,000 physicians short in the country. Huh. So a usual physician in Kaiser has about 2,000 patients. So 2,000 times 100,000 is a lot. So just think that's how many patients could potentially not have access to the healthcare system. To just a primary, this isn't even specialists, this is just primary care. So we have to think about how do we get that care. Yeah?
Why do you say that we're going to be short on physicians?
Because they can't train enough. And that we have more and more need in the healthcare system, more and more people becoming insured that weren't insured before having access to the system. And we can't train enough people to, and we have lots of retirement. So like Kaiser, I think it's like 40% of our nursing workforce is eligible for retirement. The average age of the nurse in the country is like 55 and a half. So 5 years from now, we could have like, you know, 50% less because they can all retire. So that's one thing. There's a lot of burnout as well, burnout in both physicians, nurses, because it's a hard job. I mean, imagine, man, 15-minute patients, 15-minute visits every single day for 8 hours a day, 7 days a week. It's a lot, and you're just burdened, and more and more and more is put on you without a lot of support. So it's just there's kind of like this complex set of circumstances that are making it hard, both hard to get more people and hard to keep them to stay. One of the other trends that we're seeing is that care is moving outside of the hospital to the home. So, you know, that's where healthcare started. You used to have a doctor that would take his bag and walk to your home in the, you know, farms or whatever in Ohio and California and all that. Then everybody built these big hospitals and everyone went to the hospital. And now people are like, well, the hospitals, you get infected there, it's gross. Like, don't go there anymore. We don't have enough people to take care of you. And it's really expensive to maintain this huge monolithic structure. So now we're going to move care back to the home. But we can't do it with a black bag and send everyone to your home. We're going to do it with technology. So we're going to give you this stuff that can monitor you at home and take care of you kind of remotely. So we're seeing that. So acuity in the hospitals, the sickness level of patients in the hospitals through the roof. You know, the medical surgical floor, which is like the basic, you know, you get a knee surgery, you go to med surg floor. They're running all kinds of crazy drips and medications that used to be only done in ICUs and like academic medical centers. They're doing in the podunk hospitals in rural, you know, Kansas. And so these things are, people are just getting sicker, and then the routine care is moving to the home or out into the outpatient setting. So it's a shift because, you know, we're set up to have physicians in the hospital and nurses work 24/7. We're not set up to take care of you in remote areas wherever you are. And so we have to imagine different ways of providing care. And so I'll talk a little bit about that in a second. And then nurses and nurse practitioners are usually an underutilized resource. Both legislatively, their practice is usually kind of limited in different states. Advanced practice nurses sometimes have to work under a physician license, so they can't practice independently. And then nurses are sometimes, depending on the policy of the hospital, aren't allowed to practice at the top of their license, or they're not able to do the assessments and certain procedures and things that they're able to do from a professional standpoint and a training standpoint. There's legislation that limits that. So we're not letting our workers work at a top of license, which then puts the burden on the person above them to do more things that they don't necessarily have to do. So I'll talk about that in a second. So just a couple quick examples, and these are just from things I've experienced within Kaiser, and we can talk more about other examples of this. In our Colorado region, we have, instead of throwing everyone at an OBGYN physician, we actually, when you want an appointment with an OBGYN, whether you're pregnant or just going in for routine care, you call up the number, you talk to a registered nurse. The registered nurse asks you a couple of questions about what you're going to do and what you need. And then she'll triage you, or he'll triage you two different ways. If you're complex, you have a complex surgery, complex issue, or a complex pregnancy, you go to the physician clinic. If it's routine care, moderate level of complexity, you can go to the nurse practitioner clinic. And now these two clinics are actually working top of license. So the doctors who are trained in residency to do surgery, because OBGYNs go through a surgical residency, are actually doing the complex surgical things that they were trained to do instead of, you know, doing routine care every day. And the nurse practitioners who are trained in managing, you know, chronic patients or patients with normal things or routine things are able to do what they're best at. And now you're using your resources really well. And at the beginning, the physician's like, no, we're not, we feel really uncomfortable just kind of letting this go. But then they're like, oh, now I'm doing what I got trained to do, like the complex crazy thinking that physicians are trained to do, they can do it. And the nurse practitioner is like, hey, I don't have to go in and just do pap smears all day. Like, I can actually manage chronic care and do all these things. And it just, people were really happy. And so it was great. And it was a good learning experience. And now both of the teams are working top of license, which is a really good example of how you can do that. There's also these nurse practitioner run community clinics. So there's examples all over. Kaiser's doing some in Southern California. There's some in Arizona, there's some in Ohio. But nurse practitioners can work independently in many states, not all states. And they can run clinics themselves. So you can have a nurse practitioner run clinic. It costs less to have a nurse practitioner run clinic. You can run chronic care patients through there. And then you can push the more complex patients out to the physician clinic, or however you want to, refer them out however you need to. You can have really cost-effective ways of providing quality care, and there's research showing that nurse practitioner care and physician care is equal in many ways within the both specialties and primary care. So you're just you have a new resource of primary care providers that's really only held back by legislation at this point, that you can kind of make up that 90,000 person deficit with, and there's a lot more nurse practitioner schools than there are medical schools. And so we have an opportunity to really define what is the role of the NP, what are they really good at, what does research say they can treat well, what do physicians do, what are they really good at, what can they really treat well, and then get patients to the resources that meet the needs that they have. And then the last one, so I'm actually on paternity leave right now. I have 1.5 weeks left. We just had our son 4 weeks ago on Tuesday, and it was all nurses from start to finish. We walked in to the hospital in San Leandro Kaiser. We walked in, RN triaged us, said, hey, yep, you're in labor, took us to the triage room, another nurse came in, did a couple checks, some vital signs and things, says, yep, you're getting admitted, took us back to the room. A nurse midwife came in, admitted us to the hospital. She started having painful contractions. A certified nurse anesthetist came in and did the epidural. The nurse midwife and the nurse anesthetist and the RN all delivered the baby. Then a nurse practitioner, pediatrician, came in and assessed the baby afterwards. So it was completely, we saw one pediatrician, he spent 2 minutes with us, and said, everything's good, and then left. The next day, a nurse practitioner, pediatrician came in and said, hey, I'm going to do an assessment, here's all the things, here's the pediatrician you should go see, here's, you know, like, it was completely nurse-run, which was great because we had an uncomplicated pregnancy. We didn't need all the resources of a physician and surgery and all that kind of stuff. Now, the physician's still there. If she had to go get a C-section or there's some complication or something, they can come in. But you're using really well-trained people to do the routine stuff, and it was completely RN-driven, which I was really excited about. And so, anyway. So that's kind of just an example of how we might be able to do some top-of-license stuff and how RNs fit into the picture, where care is moving, and how we might be able to optimize it. But like I said, the healthcare system is not really set up to do that well. So we have to kind of provoke thinking. That's one of the roles of our team at Kaiser, is like provoke the organization to be like, hey, guess what? It's nice that we're really good at doing some stuff, but we need to think differently and down the road. So we created this story called Imagining Care Anywhere. And Faye was really integral in this as well. But we created these personas, these fake personas, you know, created through lots of interviews and design thinking and all that kind of stuff, but to really provoke the organization to think differently about what care might look like. So we created what would the future of, like, maternity care be, and there's, like, the lady wears a wearable and tells her she has contractions and sends a text message to the hospital that she's on her way, and there's, like, a virtual market that gives her, like, only healthy stuff to eat so she can't order bad food and, like, all this kind of stuff. We have a Medicare patient where Leo and Rosemary, where they get picked up. He's having a heart issue. They get picked up in a driverless car. It drives him over to the pharmacy to get a medication. He never has to see a doctor because he does a telehealth visit on the way to the pharmacy in the car. We have the one I'll show a couple clips of is Marcus the Millennial. So Marcus the Millennial is not sick. He doesn't need any health care. He's like, why do I have to pay Kaiser to, like, not use you, all that kind of stuff. So, but then Marcus gets in a bike accident and he needs health care, and so we do it differently. There's an Uber nurse, so he's like, he can go to the hospital, or he can use the app and click the Uber nurse. The Uber nurse comes over and takes a look at him and says, you know, you're depressed and you need to do some things. And it's just a different, you know, we have to kind of push the walls. We almost had a drone come and pick Marcus up, but then we had these, like, visions of, like, the drone coming and, like, just dragging him along the ground with, like, this blood splatter, like, you know, like this cartoon kind of thing. So we said drones are out for now. We'll go with the driverless car and the Uber nurse. Anyway, we are imagining, like, hospital, home, clinic, out and about. So those are the four sites of care enabled by technology that we're really focused on. And so hospitals are still there, but they may be smaller. Clinics are still there, but we're not focusing on the inpatient and the clinic visit. We're focusing, what if you could get care anywhere you are? How do we enable that? How do we give you information to make right choices, connect with people, the right people, you know, track your own health outcomes and link it back to decisions you can make and not have to call a physician or wait on the system every time. So those are the type of things. And it's all enabled by this digital health kind of revolution. So we have these provocation questions because this is all centered on user-centered design or design thinking. So we have some design thinking experts that were trained by IDEO that have worked in our company for like 13 years, are really good at this stuff. They help us kind of think differently about these things. So we have these provocation questions. This is just one of them for Marcus the Millennial. How might KP meet our members where they are? So I'll show you two videos. One is Marcus crashing his bike. The second one is what happens after Marcus crashes his bike and how care might be a little bit different, kind of his recount of the whole experience. And we have these design principles. So as you watch the video, just kind of think about this. Convenient alternatives to traditional facilities, continuous monitoring and real-time alerts enhanced by artificial intelligence, and cost transparency and informed choices for our members. So let's see. It's very dramatic, by the way. He's a bar back and he's riding his bike home from work, by the way. So Marcus is a hit and run victim. So this is a video of him kind of recounting the experience and what happened to him.
It's so hazy. The last thing I remember was I'm riding home from work. This guy comes out of nowhere, sideswipes me, and I'm down. Then I remember an EMT scanning my arm and telling me it's a good thing I was wearing my bracelet. They got called right away. She gave me a full assessment and found I had a broken arm, sprained ankle, and a nasty road rash. I'm pissed off, hurting, and worried that the emergency room's gonna be really expensive, but she said that because it was a clean break that I could either go to the emergency room or this thing called a Blink. Who knew? The Blink was cheaper and faster. So I went there. At the Blink, it all went really fast because the EMT had sent ahead the scan of my arm. They had a 3D printed cast customized and ready to go. And then the nurse sprayed these skin cells over my rash to speed the healing. Thanks for coming to pick me up. That's so cool that you got the alerts. Can I see what they sent you?
So the EMT had a mobile x-ray machine, was able to do a quick x-ray, determined it was an uncomplicated break. Instead of taking him to the ER, because he's not a trauma patient, he doesn't have a loss of consciousness, he doesn't have multiple injuries, he has basically a broken arm and skin rash, he can go to a nurse practitioner clinic and have a 3D printed cast, because that's well within their capabilities of doing. Saves him tons of money, saves us dealing with an emergency patient, you know, and sending someone who doesn't need emergency care to an emergency room. And then what else happens? So he goes to Blink, and he's wearing a bracelet, so his friend's already notified, he's going, it alerted the EMTs he was hurt or had a, you know, like a forceful crash. All this stuff is something, this is not out of the realm of possibility now, we could do all this right now. What we'd have to do is connect the dots. So that's the biggest thing I want to say for healthcare. Like you can see all these great startups that are doing all these kind of cool stuff. The biggest bang, I think, in healthcare is connecting the dots between all these technologies, integrating these systems that already exist, 3D printing, wearables, all this stuff, making sense and actually having a clinical outcome to it. That's the biggest thing. And so it's really, it's not about the latest and greatest, coolest new Google thingy. Connect the dots first and you'll make a huge impact. So with that, I'll stop and let Faye come up and then should I do questions? I don't know, what should we do? Do you have any questions initially with this, and then we can turn over to Faye and do more at the end, too? Yeah.
I guess this might be a question that both of you can tackle, but, you know, there's tons of companies that are out there that are all working on the same sort of new technologies. How do you actually assess, you know, which ones you actually want to try piloting and which ones you don't? I think the couple articles that we ended up reading talked about, you know, measuring the benefit versus the cost itself, and sometimes there's the good enough answer. So how are you making that assessment?
Yeah, so for Kaiser, because we're huge, a big thing for us is can you scale to our size? And that's like the first leader question. You know, if you're a person in, two guys in a garage trying to build something, the likelihood of us probably doing it with you is not high. We want you to go somewhere else, build up your system, and then come back. So that's one big assessment. I think the other piece, we're really focused on outcomes. So the fact that you have a really cool gadget is great, and we'll probably look at it. But for us to pilot, we have to have some evidence that you can actually move the dial on an outcome, whether it's a business outcome or a clinical outcome. And to have that evidence, whether it's a a real clinical trial or just having, you know, some valid user data that's not, you know, they said it was great in a quote, but actually some metrics around it, those are things that pique our interest. And then ease of use and integration. So it has to, if it's going to use electronic medical record data, you need to make sure that you've figured out how to do that with Epic, because we're an Epic shop, and you need to be able to talk the same language and tell us that you can do that. If you can say, oh, we need you to talk to Epic for us, it's probably a no-go right there. We'll be like, go talk to Epic and come back when you've talked to them. So those are things that, those are just some nuances with Kaiser. The biggest thing, I think, the biggest, because we can overcome some of those things. If you have a really cool thing and you have a measurement, we can work through a lot of it. I think the clinical outcomes or the business outcomes, should, you know, with proof, is a bigger driver for us. Any other questions? Yeah.
So once you've identified something that you want to integrate, what does that process look like where you actually roll it out to patients?
Very complicated. you know, we start, it depends what you're doing. If it's going to touch patients, it goes through a lot more complicated process, security measures, and all kinds of stuff. If it's something that that's not as risky, we can do some cool little tiny pilots with a handful of people and kind of test things. We can also take you into our innovation center and do kind of mock testing or prototyping there and seeing if it's something that we want to move forward with. The biggest hurdle really is like going through our IT security teams, but we have a process to do that. And then if you need integration with the electronic medical record, that becomes a fight just because of priorities. So we have to determine if your thing is worth putting on the list of upgrades and integrations that our teams have to do, or can we do a workaround for now, and is it valuable to do a workaround while we figure that piece out in the background? So there's multiple ways into Kaiser. We're one with technology. There's other, you know, we have a venture firm you could talk to if you wanted funding, and then they can facilitate some stuff. So it just depends kind of where you want to go. Yeah.
So assuming you get here in 2025, let's push another 25 years, like to 2050. Are you guys, oh, I'm sure you guys thought about it, but you're open to the idea to, you know, like, so let's say everyone's using these type of scenarios and technology, like integrating with other service providers and utilizing, you know, you brought up the Uber model, so maybe you guys don't have someone close, but they have a hospital closer or a nurse closer. I mean, is that eventually where you see the full integration? Because, you know, you guys can scale up as much as you want, but at the end of the day, you're only Kaiser, and
yeah,
there's millions of people,
yeah, right,
that need that kind of thing, you know?
Yeah, you know, that's a good question. I think, you know, the business model of Kaiser is what we call Kaiser Permanente Medicine, which is built upon all this experience and data that we own and can sift through and gives us a competitive advantage. So I don't know where we would go in 2050. I mean, we talk about integration with strategic partners, but the strategic partners we talk to are not usually other healthcare providers. It's like the Samsungs and the Apples and the Googles to provide resources for us to do different things. But I don't know. I mean, I think eventually we'll have to shift.
Because, you know what I mean? You brought up design thinking.
Yeah.
Like, so the analogy, I think, is like, so something like the electric car, right?
Yeah.
They invented it, but then when they invented it, they realized, shit, we don't have the infrastructure to charge any of these things.
Right.
You know? So I feel like so many solutions are, like, good up to a point,
right,
and then they get to that point, and they're just like, damn, we actually got here.
Yeah.
Where do we... Where
now
do we
what, right?
Yeah, so...
Yeah, no, that's a great question. I'm sure Kaiser's thought about it somewhere, and we've had conversations about it. I think the business model shift for Kaiser would be really hard, just based on their history. I don't think I think we could get there. It would be really interesting to see what we came up with. I mean, some things that we're doing now are really moving to like a virtual care model, kind of like the Teladoc and that kind of stuff. So we have the infrastructure to actually do that ourselves. And so we can then provide care outside of where we have facilities. And so that would expand us nationally potentially, where we could provide care and then refer you to partner, like Mayo Clinic does, right? Mayo Clinic has tons of partner hospitals. Kaiser could potentially do partner hospitals. Right now, Kaiser's buying stuff. So we just bought hospitals in Maui. We just bought hospitals in Seattle, so we're just expanding our physical presence, but I think eventually we're going to not be able to do that anymore. We'll have to expand our virtual presence and then figure out how do we partner going forward.
Yeah, so it'd be like the third-party logistic
healthcare provider. Yeah, and the other thing is provide the treatment plans, because that's what our niche is, like the really good outcomes, treatment plans, cost effectiveness. Like, we could partner with the hospital, and if they were willing to adopt our way of doing things, they could succeed too. So those are all just hypothetical. I'm not Bernard Tyson. I don't know. I'm not the CEO. I'd love to talk to him about it, but but those are things that we have to think about strategically, like what can the business do. But I can turn over to Faye because I want to make sure she has plenty of time to chat, and then we'll answer questions at the end too.
How many of you declared your major? Okay, so what majors or what interests? How many do we have interest in healthcare? As like, that's where you're going. Okay, science in general, biology, chemistry, engineering? Any engineers? Engineers. Okay.
Good. It's good for me to kind of see like where your interest and kind of background is on this. And thank you so much for Dan for coming out of his fraternity.
Anything
I called him
you,
up
Faye.
Saying, as Francis and I were kind of brainstorming for this topic, and I kind of heard basically the lineup that you have a doctor, you have some of us on the innovation side, you're going to have some on pharma. This is actually a quite amazing class. I wish I had the opportunity when I was your age to have this class. It's really kind of an outside-in perspective. So I thought really important to get the kind of nursing perspective. As you see, it's quite dynamic, where it's going, growing, and where they're going in top of license. I'm going to kind of be speaking to kind of Health 2025. I first want to start off with, what is your favorite health innovation? Any of you out there? You joined this class, and what was your... Yeah.
I like the health portals online, so like UCSF is my hospital, and I can just write like basically like a text message to my doctor, and she can respond within 24 hours, so I really like that.
Great. And that's actually the Epic system, which is the same as Kaiser, but that portal system, Care Anywhere, talk to your doctor. What are some other favorite healthcare innovations for you guys that kind of drew you to this class of where you're going to 2020? Any? Or ones that you imagine? Yes.
I like the idea of telemedicine, the way it is like so convenient. I feel like there's a lot of potential in bringing healthcare services to people who can't access clinics physically.
That's actually so critical, because what we're finding is like, I think we're very lucky in the Bay Area, but in some rural areas, they have to drive hours and hours away. And really what we need is that access. And we're finding, you ask a specialist and you're like, would you like to live in this rural area? And they're like, no.
Yeah.
You know, and it's, but they still need care, and it's very critical. And when we have some heart conditions where time is so essential, these kind of virtual healthcare is very critical to that. So I'm going to kind of talk about where things are going. I'm going to have June, who's my fellow here. She's also vice president here at Kaiser, and we strategize a lot and partner and chime in at every time. So what do you actually see? This is a Center for Health Market Innovation. She's just like, health market innovations. So whether your idea of virtual care or going with telematics, they're actually now trying to reach out and say, how do we improve the health of the world's poor? Right? And you might look at also CMS and you think, oh my God, government, Medicare, bureaucracy. They have a multiple millions of dollars that they're giving out in grants to help you innovate. Right? You can apply for those grants and where you're going. So I would encourage what you see is we know as a graying of our population where we're going that we have to innovate in healthcare. In the past couple of years, billions and billions of dollars have gone into healthcare innovation from VCs, from startups, accelerators, and incubators. And that's one thing we know is that with our body, that's one thing that's going to continue. We have a graying of our population and going to be in this area. So it's definitely a hot field and where you're going, and it's wonderful that you guys are thinking out towards the future. Data. So when you were talking about how you could email your doctor, the reason why you can email your doctor is now they have a record of you. They can actually pull it up electronically. They're not going to some file room in their house trying to email you going, oh, what was her condition again? When did I see her? It's really about data. And really where we're going in the future in there.
But I think this comes to your question where you're saying, what's it going to be like in 2050? When we're now going to actually be able to predict. They're already doing that. And how many of you kind of, I don't know how many of you have given your DNA over to a source, like 23andMe. And so now it's actually looking at your genome. You can actually look at you, and they're actually looking at studies that can predict your likelihood of getting cancer, diabetes, where you're going, your genetic population, you know, your environment. But the interesting thing of that is that it predicts, but then it also, we need to get it to, how can I prevent? What can I do from there? And the interesting thing is all the discussion about healthcare is, we look at all the sensors we have. How many of you have a Fitbit, a Jawbone, a smartwatch, a smart clothing now? They actually have smart clothing that picture sensors. How many of you, or maybe you asked for your Secret Santa for some of those items as well. We actually think that the billions of amount of sensors are actually going to kind of make you smarter. My dad, I'm actually a daughter of two physicians, so I grew up in healthcare whether I wanted to or not. and actually in the offices and that. And doctors don't always make the best patients. I'm sorry, Francis. And so my dad's no exception. But he had, he thought he was just having, you know, heartburn, but he actually had like a 90% blockage of one of his arteries, you know, because he's just like, no, it's fine. I'll just take some Tums, you know. I'm just like, no, Dad, I think you should do doctor, you know, and he's like, he self-diagnosed his own diabetes and medicated himself and stuff like that. So, but I made him actually get a sensor now after his open heart surgery because he had to take 10,000 steps a day, his oxygen levels, his heart rate was and so I actually put him on some Internet of Things because he's in LA and I'm in San Francisco. It's a wonderful 1-hour flight. He's not the best patient. So it's always nice for me to be able to kind of look at my mobile app and go, huh, Dad, you're not walking too much, and I notice some things are a little off. As we start looking at our disparate populations, where they're remote, this is where it's going. We're getting smart environments, predictive sensor devices that can remotely monitor. So this is, it makes for an interesting kind of concept. This is another interesting one. As you kind of look at it, anyone have been on Smart Patients or patients like me or heard of any of those sites? I see a few nods. So here, Smart Patients actually was built around actually cancer patients. So what was happening is you might have a very rare form of cancer. Your doctor in your area might not have maybe seen one, two cases in his career. You might be, you know, but now you're reaching out to the world and basically finding patients like you, sharing what works, what doesn't, what their doctor said, things, alternative treatments, where they should go. And we're actually finding that is very helpful. The likes of Kaiser, Mayo, Cleveland Clinic are using these communities to help research forward. Before, in kind of the old days, you kind of looked at the doctor and they are all knowing. But now it really is a joint decision making. You're finding things on the internet, you know about your family history more than a doctor ever will. You know, another interesting thing is we think about our health and we always think doctor, hospital, but you think about it, that's actually only a sliver of your total health. That 40% of your health is actually within your control. How you sleep, how you eat, your posture, you know, your activity levels. You have control of your more of the health than actually your doctor has. Maybe you see them once a year. Maybe you know. So really, it's really within your with your means. So this is kind of the vision of total health in the future. I thought it was so intriguing to me. Part of it is because I'm a workaholic. So the vision describes how shorter working hours, more contact with outside environment, growing local production and consumption, and redistribution of wealth and where we're going, kind of like this well-being for the future. And what's interesting for all of you is, what does health 2025 mean to you? What does well-being mean to you? I think what you saw when we were trying to go through the personas, that, you know, as Dan was describing, is we find everyone's vision of their own health as being very different. And it's a very personal decision.
So some examples of that are, right, so we were, you know, an elderly woman not taking very good care of herself, she's a grandmother, takes more care of her kids and everything, and we're like, you really need to take care of your diabetes, you really need to come here, you need to take your medication. She's like, whatever, I'm just here because my daughter made me come. But if you talk to her on her level of what she wants, it was like, would you like to see your granddaughter graduate from high school? Ooh, you got her attention. If you want to extend your life by 4 years, you need to start taking care of the medication, you need to lose weight, you need to eat less sugar. So everyone has a different trigger. You might try that. That's not going to work on a younger person. It's not going to work on someone else. So you really need to find what motivates them. And I think that's a different hard thing about healthcare. How many know you know that, right? If we exercise a little bit more, we get our 8 hours of sleep, and we drink 8 cups of water, we'll be healthier. But how many of us change our behavior because of that? Just because we're informed, right? Doesn't matter. How many New Year's resolutions are broken, right? Everyone sees that. The gym memberships go up, and everyone gets that new workout equipment, and then the best time to buy used workout equipment is February, right? And they're like, forget it. Takes up too much space. Take it out. But so that's an interesting part, you know, that you're going to see. So connectivity of care and kind of a personalized one. This is how I was kind of talking about, is you really have to get personalized with it. But there's a real fear. Now imagine you're all hooked up, your blood pressure, you're this, your genomics is online, you're blah, 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 you know who you're related to in the world, you know your gene. How about if someone hacks that? Do you know that on the black market, your healthcare information is 10, 20 times more valuable than your credit card information? Because you can't change it. Credit cards, you can change, right? They can use it for money and they can go. But they can sell your healthcare data at a lot higher price. So as you start looking at connected care, connected devices, or connected homes, there is a fear of security and privacy and where we're going. So those are some things. I think you're in one of the most interesting times in healthcare because we are really transforming the model, as Dan was saying. Who is doing it? What is doing it? What's your role in it? And it is a cross-functional time.
Sorry, I just want to comment. You were talking about, you know, find whatever it is that'll change that behavior for that person. But I think the irony is that, you know, as we become more and more dependent on technology, I don't know, there's some part of me that's, sorry, I'm not in the health anything, so this might feel a little off topic, but, you know, I have grandparents and older aunts and uncles who, I mean, they literally live on the mentality like, oh, I'll just go. Hey, you shouldn't be doing that, Grandma and Grandpa. Oh, it's fine. My doctor will give me something for it. You know, the analogy is like, think about maps, like just navigating around the city. No one knows how to use a map anymore because why? You know, we have our phone. We've learned to depend on it. And this just kind of scares me. I see the health and the benefits of everything. But, you know, as we become more dependent on these technologies, there's less social and group responsibility for us to take care of ourselves because we're operating on, I mean, we always hear like, oh, innovation's happening so quick, oh, they're discovering all these things so quickly. Like, I mean, I can't tell you how many like older people I've talked to is like, they literally don't worry about what they have because they're just like, oh my doctor, like there'll be a cure for it by that time, you know, and it's just like, it's interesting. And then you add to that the security threats. I mean, utility companies are being hacked into every day, and that's like a physical infrastructure. If you just have the stuff that's 20 times worth more than, you know, your credit card information just floating in the cloud, like, someone's going to get that. You know, someone's going to get that. So it just scares me a lot, actually.
You know, and that fear actually is very common. So it's not just you, and I'm glad you actually raised that, because I think it's true. I think there's some interesting forces. You have this kind of thing of technology, right? Kind of trying to, quote unquote, take care of you. But you actually have another interesting force that's happening here. As you start looking at your insurance, it's actually putting more accountability on you. So you're actually, before, you didn't have to know how much it costs. now you're actually having more accountability on how much it costs. And they're actually going to try and switch the paradigm. There's a lot of discussion right now about basically saying, before it was like, for your doctors were incented by how many times you went to visit. So of course they want you to visit a lot. Come on in! So they get to charge every time. Now, if they're charged on the outcome, they want to get you as healthy as possible. You want to get as healthy as possible because you don't want to pay to get a service. So there's kind of, to your point, there's this very conflicting kind of pressures on the system. And I do think part of it's scary. Like, some are saying, we'll just go total technology. Why do we need doctors? We're just going to put everything in the system and it will spit out the answer, right? You know, it's Dr. Watson at the top prime. But we know when it comes down to it, there's something about the high touch as well as high tech. When we see kind of, you know, at being in hospitals, you see some dire situations. Do you want a computer? We actually had robots come in and do teleconsult, and you have the face of someone video consulting. And that's nice for the kids love it. They feel like it's Disney and the little guy's coming, and they know the robots can't give them shots, so they're like, yay, let me see the robot. But for those dire situations where you're, like, getting discovered that you have a very, you know, a cancer, do you want to be talking about it with, like, a robot? I'm like, you want that personal touch. So I think this is going to be this very interesting journey that we're on right now. So it's just, it's a very interesting time. And there are a lot of people share your fears. There are some people that that we have the whole online system, as you were mentioning, and we've got great adoption, but we found pockets, and actually it's been really interesting. They're like, no way, I'm never going to get on that portal. I don't want my information anywhere. I'm not going to have a digital footprint. Big Brother's watching me. No way. And so you're going to always have this interesting balance.
Yeah, but I mean, a lot of these technologies you're talking about are, like, actually, you know, like the video he played with the broken wrist thing.
Yeah.
Like, that's something actually in you. Like, could you imagine just one mess up, one quality control mess up by one company? No one's going to want that. And it's like, all of a sudden, let's say you even went 15 years with no mistakes, no deaths, but then someone's arm explodes while they're walking down the street, or, you know, something that's exaggerating, but something like that. It's just like, it just seems so fragile, you know. It just seems like, you know, you can go 30 years and, you know, Francis, we've talked about this. It's like, you can go your entire medical career as a doctor, no malpractice suits, and then at the very end, you have one person that just, for whatever reason, you mess up.
Right.
And then everything before that is negated from that point forward. So it's just like, seems like a lot of eggs in one basket, and then, like, they're very super extra fragile eggs. So.
Yeah. Well, there's the balance. There's also the human error.
Yeah. Well, that's the impetus for a lot of this, right, is the IOM report, where you have 100,000 deaths a year based on medical errors. And so I think people are like, well, we can do better. And so there, I mean, one response is technology. One response is, you know, reimbursement reform with outcome focus and that kind of stuff. And now they're estimating it's like 200 or 300,000 deaths a year. And so the system was fragile at the beginning. And so I think people are, and that's kind of why we're in this weird space where people are trying to solve problems that are so complex. People are throwing technology at it, they're throwing policy at it, they're throwing politics at it. Like, no one knows what to do because it's a human problem. And so they're trying to take some of the human element out, but then also we know healthcare is human. And so it's like this balance of how do you do that, and no one knows. And so, you know, like, it's easy for Amazon to say, well, it sucks to go to the store, so put it online and get it there in the next day or an hour. Like, that's easy. But to do that for healthcare, it's like, well, some stuff I do want to just type on I had an ear infection the other day. I had to wait. So I called, and they said, well, you can schedule a telephone appointment the next day. It's midnight. I know I have an ear infection. I have pus coming out. I know in 5 hours it's going to hurt really bad, but I have nowhere to go except for the ER. And I'm a Kaiser patient. I'm like, I should know the system and be able to work it to get it, but I had to wait. So at 9 a.m., I had a telephone call. She's like, oh, yeah, you have an ear infection. Go get an antibiotic. I mean, that could have been taken care of 5 hours ago, and if that was a bad infection, it could have been really worse. I could have ruptured eardrum, all kinds of stuff. That's where I wanted technology. It's like, I have an ear infection. Like, here's my stuff. Fix it. And then there's other things like, you know, with my son, like, I don't want to go see a robot or call somebody, like, touch him, fix him, like, this is a little baby, like, I don't want you to do it with the computer. So it's just that, it's a weird balance, and I think people are trying to figure it out, and that's what we need you guys to do, is, like, figure it out, like, what is that balance, because, you know, like, we talk a lot about the elder population, and we need to focus on them, and they're a big consumer of healthcare, but you're going to be an elder population soon. And so build for the future. And, like, what do you want when you're there? And what skill set and resources do you want to have? But it's tough. I mean, no one has an answer. And so we have to throw stuff at it or have some sort of epiphany.
Right. So talking about elder population in 2025, this is a number 65 and plus. The significant amount of increase that's going to be really lays kind of a very interesting burden on the society, on our care system, and where we're going. And if you think about these mega trends, you know, in Japan they call it the silver tsunami. They actually have more older people than younger people now. And the younger people are going out, and they're they work farther away. They're actually looking at companion robots, because there are now elder people by themselves, can't get their medications, can't remember them, so they're actually going to robotics. Kind of an interesting dichotomy from there, because they don't have the alternative. They don't have a human touch because their relatives live far away, they work in Tokyo, and they're in a remote area. So there's an interesting phenomenon happening in this area. And I think you guys will be getting that. You'll be kind of sandwiched between taking care of your parents and taking care of your kids.
You can inherit all the old people.
That's right. Every generation has to do it. We can just do it with technology now.
It's just that these generations have lived longer.
Yeah.
And that's what we're finding, is our life expectancy is getting longer. And that's what's happening as we're living longer. So these are just a few more, but as far as kind of trends. But I wanted to get, you know, kind of from you, and how are we doing on time? I haven't been longer.
7:08.
Okay. Yeah. If there are any questions or comments, I wanted June to kind of talk to. She has definitely been my partner. We partnered a lot on innovations, and she sees a lot out there from her perspective. For some of her engineering parts, she is actually the more qualified engineer.
Well, I'll just say this. First of all, I saw one or two engineering hands. So I'm an electrical engineer by training. So I've got a bachelor's and master's. And I also have it in systems engineering. But then I went and did the business route as well. And you were talking about how does the technology change and how all the companies try and partner. Because everybody sees a future with healthcare right now, right? This is one of the areas, you know, I think in industry, there is a future in that. Whether you want to be on the clinical side, whether you want to be on the technical side. I'm also going to offer right now where I'm at, I'm on the business and commercial side. So I'm dealing with a lot of the vendors and the providers. And here's the deal. What we're trying to do is change the dynamic and start to partner with people. If our vendors are providing technology, you know they're spending a fortune on R&D. And so what we're saying is, if you could come and bring that forward, we've been having innovation forums with them. You have to sign non-disclosures, et cetera. But wouldn't it be powerful if you could go then talk to the clinicians, and the nurses, the doctors, et cetera, and they look at where you're at with your innovation, and they could give you clues. If you went this way and you made these enhancements, it would be so much more powerful, because that's the end consumer for your device. What it's doing is speeding up the development time and time to market. But at the same time, not asking companies like Kaiser, who their core competency shouldn't be developing those, you know, devices, you know, the clinical devices and care. What ours should be is providing the service. What we're seeing is it's a very good partnership. And the other thing is, too, we're all talking about cost of healthcare. One of the biggest things, and this is why I'm in healthcare right now, right? I mean, I want my kids, my grandkids, and all of you be able to afford healthcare, and the way it's rising, you know, and yet we look at ourselves and we go, hey, we're 24th in the whole world in terms of quality of care. So you've got to start changing the paradigm and start looking at the companies that are out there and saying, can we partner in a different way? And I'm telling you, the receptivity is fantastic. fantastic. They are seeing it. It's helping them to get their product onto market. And quite frankly, yeah, you want some differentiation. Like if we have something that's going to give us a competitive advantage and edge in our care, that may be 20% of your cost, right? But the rest of it should be out there in the consumer world and share it with everybody, right? I mean, so it's changing people's business models, right? And we're kind of lucky. Kaiser's a nonprofit, right? So we invest like $2 billion plus a year in community events and things of that sort and trying to make sure that we can deliver the care throughout the country. But that gives us a different prerogative to maybe go, hey, can we partner with you and get things moving faster? It's really exciting because you're trying to decide what careers you want to pursue. And what it's saying is you can go into business and still have that impact. You can go into technology and still have that impact. Or you can be a clinician and practicing and still have that impact. You are in a much better place than I would say our generation was, quite frankly.
Come
not
on,
that I'm trying to date us, but, you know. But it is. It's the business side, it's the commercial side, and it's the technology side and bringing it all together. And it's thinking about your end patients. It's also, if we leave you with nothing else, we should be leaving you with the concept of think from an outcome perspective. What do you want? What would make a difference in your personal life, right? And that's what's making a differentiation, I think, for Kaiser, is we have to always start with the outcome and work backwards. And I know for a lot of you, intuitively, you're like, of course, she's saying something that just should seem like commonplace. But you'll be surprised when all of you are out there, either in your internships or you're actually working, you'll find that you can get lost in what I'll call the individual tactical steps and lose sight of your end goal. And if you have that internal compass of where I'm trying to head to, when you hit those roadblocks and speed bumps, you don't get so frustrated and you still see where you're trying to rise towards, because it's going to take your generation to move us forward in a powerful way. So those are some of my thoughts.
Thanks, Jane. Any questions or comments?
I have a question. Where does, like, so decreasing cost for health, pharmaceutical companies account for like some of the biggest like health costs. Like I know I have prescriptions that cost upwards of $500. So where does like those partnerships in future, does that lead to maybe a decrease in those charges, or will we see increase in pharma because of the changing like doctor prescription kind of stuff?
Yes, no, very good question. You are actually going to have another speaker from Genentech coming in, Gail Chen. So you can ask her, remember that question, so you can ask her too. We do have to address it, kind of the increasing cost where we're going. And actually, we're going to see pharma's trying to go upstream because they're also finding that clinical trials are so expensive. They're trying to innovate the way they do it, trying to reduce their cost. But they're also saying not just the pill is not in itself, it's really your care regimen. You could take that wonderful diabetes pill and then eat a bunch of donuts and then do this and then just take the pill again, right? But it doesn't. You have to look at it more holistically. So they're trying to go upstream. Mm-hmm. So we're trying to find it. And I think they're going to find that as a country, we're not going to allow as the demands of their increasing price. That's what happened to the insurance side. Mm-hmm. The insurance side would just take cost and add, right? And then all of a sudden legislation said, no, I don't think so. Mm-hmm. And it's happening all across the industry. So they're having to innovate the way they do it. But Gail will be here, so they need questions.
Do you think that innovations will also change the way that, like, clinical trials are run? Because I know now that it takes, like, upwards of 12 years for a drug to get on the market.
Yeah.
So
yes,
will it change?
I think that's where wearables and that whole population piece is going to be huge. Because mm-hmm. now you have to enroll them on pieces of paper, and they have to come to this one clinic, and they have to get that one shot, and it has to be randomized. You can take a lot of that and disperse it out into larger populations, and the more people you can test on, the better, faster you'll get answers. So I think that'll be a big deal.
Okay. Yeah, they're actually debating on that, being very creative. In a sense,
yeah.
Crowdsourcing.
Yeah, it's crowdsourcing.
Yeah,
I'm going to answer something else that I want you to think about. And you've seen it on TV, like GoodRx and some of these other pharmaceutical websites. And here's the deal. I'll use me as the example. There's a medicine that I take that nothing else other than the coupon, mm-hmm. you as consumers are going to change the game. The technology is mind-blowing, and people understand, you know, you guys are so savvy with all of this, and it makes a big difference. And bottom line is, these companies want to stay, you know, in business and want a good business model, but the competitive pressures. And the other thing, too, is, and you guys are really exposed to this, the global impact. Many of you have heard of, you know, people go over to India or to Brazil or to China to go do their operations, especially if they're going to be out of their own pocket, right? So we have to think of better ways to provide more effective quality care in a more affordable way.
Thank you.
I don't know if we have time, actually. Just one quick question. So, obviously, Kaiser's really moving towards population health or solving the patient problems before they even have to come to the hospital. When you look at the innovations that your group is working with, how much of it is actually clinical products or clinical solutions versus the population health solution?
We don't do a whole, like, clinical devices, we don't do a whole lot with. We do intervention things, so we're working with something called Picture It, which is like an obesity avatar program for weight loss. We're doing some diabetes management type things. Actual physical, like, IV pumps and that kind of stuff, we don't tend to mess with.
We hacked them.
We have hacked them, yeah.
In our innovation lab, we were testing them out from the vendor. First to hack it, and then we said, you know, they need to address it. So, I would say there's kind of a whole range of different ones, and I think also it depends on which system you're in, right? So if you are in Mayo, they actually do a lot of device innovation. They have a whole fabrication shop and do a device. Cleveland Clinic is actually spinning off companies. So depending on which system, they have different kind of priorities and focus areas.
And some you know, just consider innovation research. So they put a lot of money into kind of R&D type clinical trial, almost research projects, and funded from NIH and that kind of stuff. So it just depends. Everyone kind of has their own culture. Kaiser is very, technology and kind of system innovation type stuff internally, where others are spinning off companies. Kaiser doesn't really deal with IP. Like, we kind of just give it away. We're not very good at IP.
We're a nonprofit,
but it just depends on kind of each system has its own culture, and academic medical centers are very different than, you know, others, and so it just depends kind of where you're at.
Two more questions?
I was just wondering, how do, like, insurance costs and things like that fit into the changing technology and, like, telemedicine and things like that? Like, will it change the way that you're billed? Will it change the way that, like, things like that happen?
Yeah, it actually has a huge impact.
Yeah.
So telehealth or virtual health, I think that's one of you mentioned, it's been around here for decades, actually, now. But the reason why it's been so slow is it hasn't been reimbursed by insurance, and it hasn't been reimbursed by the government. And so only when you start getting that, because people don't want to do something if they're not reimbursed, right? And so it actually has a very important implication.
Question for you. How do patients from the general population react to being seen only by the nurse practitioners instead of doctors? Are they looking at it as something positive, or?
You know, it kind of depends on, you hear stories both ways. Like, I want to see the doctor because I'm ingrained that the doctor's the only one that can solve my problem, and you get people like that. And then others are surprised, and they don't know the difference. Others are like, I only see my nurse practitioner because she actually listens to me. Like, you know, there's just a range of things. I think the evidence is showing that that nurse practitioners and physicians in many ways have similar outcomes in certain areas. So people are getting more used to the term. What's confusing people now is now the entry level for a nurse practitioner is a doctorate. So now they're a doctor of nursing practice. And so now what do you call them? Now everyone's a doctor, right? So that's kind of something that they're trying to figure out. And there's a lot of, like, you can go online and just read articles, like, on both sides, like, nurses will never do this, and physicians are idiots, and everybody's, and it's really comes down to the care, and the really good teams are the ones that work collaboratively, and I think that's more where it's going to go, is that you may not have your own physician in the future. You actually, the system knows you, because we have so much information that when you call us up, we're like, oh, hey, Jeremy, you're awesome. So, you know, here's all the things I know about you and what happened last, and I'm going to take care of you today, and you've never seen me, but I know you. And I think that's kind of where we're going to move to at some level for the general population. Now, when you're super sick and you need to be managed by a person, like, that will happen. But I think generally, if we can know you better, we can provide you personalized care no matter who you see. We just route you to who you need to see, because that you're going to get the best outcome with that provider.
And I would offer this, and I think you'll see this, and I know I do it a lot too. You guys are really busy. You've got a lot of stuff in school and whatnot. Let's be honest, unless you're really needing a doctor, if you can pick up a phone and say, here are my symptoms, have somebody go order you your prescription, it's on a Saturday or Sunday, it's no big deal. And that's what I love about Kaiser, because I'm also a member of Kaiser as well as, you know, an employee. And I love it because you can just, okay, I really don't need to come see you anymore. Sometimes they even want to see you. You're like, no, I know this. We've been down this path. Just order the prescription. Years ago, you were never able to do that, but that's more about you and personalization. I don't need to see the person. Just prescribe the medicine. You saved me the doctor's visit. You gave me back my time, and I'm solving my problem faster, and I'm going to get well faster, right? I mean, but with that, it's all because you have the medical.
Yeah,
right?
It's all because we have
the data. Yeah. And go, oh yeah, I know.
We can know exactly where you left off.
Right.
One last question. So, I know there's been government like regulation already catching up to like, okay, people don't have access to health care, and that's when the Affordable Care Act passed. But now are they trying to catch up to? Are they doing anything to catch up to the whole technological advancements in health care, like trying to regulate that in some way so that it becomes like? I know it kind of defeats the purpose of like liberal free market, but are they doing anything whatsoever to like kind of, I don't know, standardize technology?
There are several industry consortiums looking towards standards. That actually was done in the telehealthcare, but now it's going to be devices. Because the one thing actually now is everyone, in healthcare it's an interesting dynamic. It doesn't happen. Everyone's trying to get own everything. Like they want to own the whole channel, and they don't communicate with others. It's almost like if you put a plane together, but the wings don't operate with the steering system because it's bought by another manufacturer. Because they're like, no, we want you to buy our wings. And so healthcare is in that industry where everyone's kind of fighting for the path, but it needs to get to its standards for safer care and where we're going. So you'll see some work on data standardization. Like, you wouldn't believe, like, the term, you know, like, some of the, you think the most fundamental, like, I always laugh, the term, you know, like, employee or FTE is not even standardized in our system. Or, like, some silly data items are not standardized across. So when I say, something here, it doesn't mean there.
In our system, you can type head of bed to chart head of bed, like you raise it or lower it or whatever, certain degrees for a head injury patient. You can chart it 30 different ways in our system, and it doesn't map back to a single data source. So when you want to run data analytics, you have to know the 30 ways we can chart it so you can actually run any kind of smart thing on it. So it's just that, it's that type of stuff. There's no like data master set that everything maps back to, and so they're working on that. And then like Faye said, you know, Epic wants to own this whole vertical and don't integrate with anything. Well, Cerner wants to do the same thing. So now when you're a patient with two different systems, you can't talk to each other, you know, or you have this great technology that doesn't talk to Epic, so we can't use it. And so those are the type of things that we need to overcome. And it's getting better. I think people are starting to open their systems because the consumers are demanding it. But it's a huge barrier right now. There's huge silos in data. And that's, I think, a big issue for us and for the data analytic companies. I mean, you can look and go to HIMSS, which is like, did it already happen, or it's
no,
like
it's
next week?
Up.
It's coming up. There's like 500 data analytic healthcare companies, and none of them have special sauce because none of them have a master data set and can link into the medical records that we have. So, you know, it's just really interesting. Everyone's trying to own everything, and the special sauce is in connecting the dots. Like I said, if you can connect the dots, you will be the next Epic, the next Judy Faulkner, the next Steve Jobs, like that. If you can connect the dots in a meaningful way for people, that's the holy grail right now in healthcare.
So what is HIMSS?
Oh, sorry. HIMSS is the Health Information Management Systems, Health Information Management Systems Society. It's like the biggest healthcare technology trade show in the world. It's in Vegas this year. If you ever have a chance to go, you should go and just bug all the salespeople and just see all the stuff. It's interesting. It's
It's overwhelming.
It's overwhelming.
Like 20,000 people.
Yeah.
You have to really go.
It's like four football fields worth of stuff.
Wear comfortable shoes.
Yeah, wear comfortable shoes.
One last question.
There's lots of happy hours.
So you sort of spoken about data and methods of collecting data. So so do you think the next important step is to like have better sensors or sensors that can sense more data, or is it more in the data analytics side? Can you make sense of it?
It's going to be data analytics.
Yeah, I think
you
it's
know,
making
you've
sense.
Probably heard this in many of your classes. I mean, this is going to sound, you know, old-fashioned, but it's data, information, knowledge, and wisdom. We have tons of data. But the reason why you can't move over to a robot right now, like Watson that IBM is promoting, is there's still a lot of art in the science, right? I mean, you start having a lot of these interconnections and stuff like that, that's where the knowledge and the wisdom and those protocols, you're never going to replace real people,
yeah.
Because it's that intuition. It's what those doctors, those nurses, et cetera, they've studied all these nuances. But when we can make protocols that make sense about a lot of it, that's that next level. That is really the holy grail. If we can really make that come to the next level of fruition, whoever it is, it's going to really be very rich.
Yeah, I mean, one example is like, so now we have sensors that can take your blood pressure every second, and so we can know that, but doctors and nurses aren't trained to know what to do with your blood pressure every second. They know how to deal with it every week or month or like year, and like over time. So we need people to help us make sense of what's the value of knowing every minute detail of your body every second and actually diagnose and treat based on that, and the medical model isn't set up to do that right now. So I think that's the next step, and that'll blow up the wearable space, and then the sensors will come along, and we'll know like, hey, we need this other piece of information. Let's build the sensor to do that. But with all the stuff we have, we don't have to do with it, or who to send it to, or how to treat on it, or any of that. So I think that's kind of the next level of kind of managing that data and knowing what to do with it.
One question that someone had on regulation. So just on the sensors and mobility and where we're going, the FDA actually has come down, you know, has been kind of there. You actually, if you have any device that does any diagnostics, even if it's a mobile app, you have to get an FDA approved. That adds a year to your cycle. So if you're doing any startups in there,
contact the FDA now.
Yes. So thank you, everyone. It was a pleasure
having
you.